This is a Famicom Junior. The video signal is connected to a modern LCD television. The inserted game is the Super Mario Bros. Duck Hunt Double Cartridge. As you can see, I am able to play the game without a CRT television. This is not faked. If the gun isn't facing the ducks when shooting, they are not hit. A normal zapper wouldn't work on a LCD TV for two reasons. It looks for light signals with a frequency of 15 kHz, as this is the horizontal refresh rate of CRT TVs. The console sends objects such as white squares to the screen and instantly tries to measure whether the gun is pointed at them. Even if the light signal was at the right frequency, the game would look for the light signal before it is even transmitted from the LCD because the video signal is too delayed. In this video, I'm using the so-called modern mallet, which consists of two parts. A new gun PCB, which reacts to light signals from DC up to 7 kHz. The board was made in a way which allows it to distinguish between the light from the TV and the light of the sun or lamps inside the room. The second part is a PCB which is connected between console and the original game cartridge. It patches the game ROM to accommodate for the lag which LCD TVs typically introduce. The board is so small that it can fit into NES cartridges together with the game PCB. Development of modern mallet started in 2016 by Metzesta, which was founded by Jeff Keacher. In June 2018, Metzesta launched a Kickstarter campaign. The idea was to raise capital to produce and sell a limited number of modern mallet within the USA. Sadly, the Kickstarter wasn't able to raise enough money. I contacted Jeff during the campaign and we are writing emails since. He has sent me the modern mallet unit I'm showing here for testing. Furthermore, I was lucky enough to get an interview from him, of which I'm going to show some parts in this episode. So far I've tried two LCD TVs, an ultra short throw projector and the screen of my notebook computer. They all worked flawlessly. Launching the game when the cartridge is connected via the modern mallet patch PCB will display a little text at the start screen of the game. If the desired game mode is chosen, the screen goes blue for a brief moment in order to measure the delay, which is then remembered and compensated in all following shots. I tested the compatibility of modern mallet with the open source scan converter and it worked flawlessly. Knowing that the problem with the light frequency is fixed with the modern mallet gun PCB, I went on to try the modified gun with the normal non-patched version of Duck Hunt in different variations. The OSSC processes video signals very quickly and setups using it are known for having between 0 and 1 frame of lag. Sadly, this is enough to break the compatibility. Shooting the gun while it faces the blue sky sometimes is interpreted as a hit. Some modern NES alternatives with HDMI output advertise themselves as being completely lag-free. This is of course untrue, but I was intrigued to test the modern mallet gun PCB with an analog anti-mini. Sadly, the introduced lag is way too high and no hits were registered at all. I will go on testing with the RetroTINK 2X in the future. I talked to Jeff about that and he assumes that probably none of these lag-free bob interlaces will be fast enough, as LCD televisions typically buffer and wait for a complete frame before they draw it, whereas CRT TVs start drawing the frame as soon as the first fragment of incomplete information is received. Amongst clone systems, so far I just tried a PAL Micro Genius, which wasn't able to run the patched game. I asked Jeff whether he went on playing many light gun games after he enjoyed Duck Hunt so much as a child.
Yeah, you know, when I was growing up, I used to love Duck Hunt in particular. It was the game that my friends had. We were a Sega house, actually, but my friends had a Nintendo. And whenever I'd go over to their house, yeah, I'd always play Duck Hunt specifically. So for me, it was a fondness of Duck Hunt. But yeah, I played other light games and like on games and arcades and so forth, and they're fun. But for this nostalgia, it was really all about Duck Hunt for me.
More current games are also of interest to Jeff. I asked him what system he uses to play them.
Most PC these days,
Right,
so
right.
yeah, yep. I'm actually we're getting big into sim racing at the moment. So, and for that, I'm actually going old school. So not even the latest sim racers, but there's a game called R Factor, which is was well regarded in terms of simulation quality. So I like driving cars in real life, and I find that it's fun to have a game that reflects reality in a simulation sense. So.
Jeff deeply appreciates what game designers did in the 80s.
And really just marvel at how complicated the games were. I
Yes.
find this even more interesting having looked at the Duck Hunt game code now.
Yeah.
So in order to do this mod, I had to go through and essentially rewrite a good deal of the game. So in order to do that, I needed to understand how the game worked in the first place. And to see the ingenuity of the engineers from the early 80s to implement what they did, given such extreme resource constraints, very little memory, very, very tight timing, not a very fast processor. Really quite amazing what they were able to accomplish there.
Jeff told me about the challenges he had to face during the development.
There were a number of challenges. It was one of those things where I thought the project would take far less time than it actually did. It ended up being far more complicated. In concept, all you need to do is account for the extra delay in the TV. That seems so simple. The reality is so much harder. Also, the problem of the gun, like the light gun, the zapper, not being able to see the TV in the first place. So, many stages of frustration. Move forward a little bit, then run into some other new problem that I hadn't been able to see before, and I have to step back and redesign. At one point, I got things working well on my own TV, and then realized that because of how my TV worked, it was a particular Vizio model. The backlight used PWM, pulse width modulation, to vary the brightness of the backlight. And I was using that as a way to filter out the screen from environmental light. And then I realized that not all TVs do that. And so I went up to play the game at a friend's house with a different TV, and it didn't work at all. And so I had to go back to the drawing board to completely redesign the zapper electronics. Yes, yeah, so that was it was frustrating, but it was a good experience too, because it was a necessary change to the game to improve it, because not everybody would have the same TV that I did. So,
Apart from this light sensing issue, another difficulty lays in the timing and the time scale the patch board is operating at.
there were some issues with the patch board that sits between the unmodified game cartridge and the NES. There was a lot of complexity there, because essentially what it's doing is applying the patch that I wrote in real time against the existing game code. And in order to do that, it has to essentially recognize where it is in the game and determine whether or not a patch is required, and offer that patch up all within far less time than one machine cycle of the NES. So we're talking in the order of tens of nanoseconds here. And so there was a lot of complexity there. There's a lot of debugging that needed to happen. One issue arose where everything would be fine until about round 8 in Duck Hunt, and then the game would start getting strange crashes and visual artifacts and so forth. And eventually determined that I was off by about, there was a timing issue where the patch board was off by about 10 nanoseconds in a particular operation. And so that was a very, very small amount of time to be off by. And so I had a great deal of difficulty in determining what the problem even was, why this was happening, and then fixing it, because it's, again, a very small timing issue.
I asked Jeff what he liked about doing Modern Mallard.
It was a great learning experience. It had to touch so many different disciplines, had to do so much hardware design, understand certain analog design to make the photodiode and so forth, and the analog front end work in the zapper electronics, the replacement board there. Had to learn 6502 assembler to patch the game. Had to learn how NES games work. I didn't really understand how they were written. there are peculiarities to the NES about how you have to interact with the PPU, which is the graphics chip, and some other things. And there are timing issues, and there are weird memory things, and there are bugs. And so you have to work around those and understand them. So it was a great educational experience. I hadn't done anything with the NES before. It was frustrating at times, but it was very fulfilling at the same time. So.
Personally, I see Modern Mallet as a highly important proof of principle rather than just a way to play Duck Hunt, and I would love seeing companies using this technology for new games. Therefore, I asked Jeff whether he would be open to license portions of Modern Mallet to others.
I'd certainly be receptive to licensing the technology. I think it's kind of a shame that we haven't seen any light gun games recently. The ones that claim to be light gun-esque are really just emulating it. We see things using the Wiimote, for example,
That's
to
true. That's true.
determine positions and so forth, but not really a true light gun game, and there are latency issues and there's some other problems with that. So it'd be neat to see a true light gun game coming along. Either an old title that has been brought forward, kind of like I did with Duck Hunt and Modern Mallard, or something completely novel. And if a company were interested, I'd certainly be open to that conversation.
On that matter, I asked whether Jeff contacted Nintendo regarding the Modern Mallet project.
I haven't contacted them. If they were interested, I would certainly be open to it. I'm kind of mostly concerned with them not suing me. I don't. The reason I'd be concerned about that is just being very specific to Duck Hunt. I wanted to make sure that I wasn't infringing on their copyrights or trademarks or anything else. And that was a lot of the reason behind doing this patch board, for example. So people would ask, well, why didn't you just distribute the game in its patched form, rather than having the separate patch that is applied to the existing game? And the answer is copyrights. Nintendo is very assertive about enforcing their intellectual property, which is totally understandable. But I wanted to have something that could actually distribute, which meant not distributing the original game code. So yeah, if Nintendo were interested, I'd be receptive to that. They
Cool.
that we haven't had any contact though.
Sadly, the Kickstarter campaign failed. The situation is still rather fresh, and Jeff is not yet sure how to carry on with the project.
Yeah, what to do next now that the Kickstarter wasn't successful? I've had mixed thoughts. I'm not entirely certain about how to proceed from here. One thing that's been unexpected is the number of people who have reached out after the Kickstarter ended to ask if they could purchase the kit anyway. And I've had to kind of demur and say, well, I'm not quite sure yet, which is the truth. I'm not quite sure yet. The trouble with this sort of thing, the trouble with any sort of hardware development, is it's incredibly expensive and time consuming and so forth to do small runs of hardware. So to make only a few hundred or a few thousand of something is surprisingly expensive and difficult. In certain ways, it's a lot easier to make tens of thousands of something. So as much as anything else, it's a question of volume and quantity and how to make the numbers work given low quantities. One other point on that front is, yeah, people will say, well, you look at the components and you come up with the bill of materials, the BOM. You say, well, it's only X number of dollars. And that's true, but there's a lot more that goes into it. There's a lot of testing and assembly costs and packaging and design for all these things and all these sort of sunk costs that can't be amortized over a large number of units if there are only a small number of units. So making the numbers work is the biggest challenge. I feel like I have the technical part solved. It's a question now of the economics, making it work from a financial standpoint.
To stay informed on Modern Mallet, there is a dedicated website.
Probably modernmallard.com. That will be eventually developed to do something other than just point to the Kickstarter that didn't work out. So that will become more useful. And that might be one of the outcomes. Like perhaps the outcome will be just put everything up there eventually if I decide not to pursue it as a commercial venture.
My acknowledgement goes to Jeff Keacher for inventing the outstanding Modern Mallet project. The generosity to send me a unit, and for being so kind doing this interview with me. This is the end of the review. My name is Ben. I thank you for viewing.
Thank you for your interest in light gun games and modern mallard.